It's now time for Talkin' Boxing with Billy C. It began as a podcast, went live on the net, and transformed into a full-blown empire. Across the web, on Fight Now TV, and on radio stations around the world. It's the only daily boxing talk radio show on the planet, hosted by the only guy with the balls to do it. Many have stepped into the ring. Many have tried to take the belt. And one by one, they've fallen. Another victim of the undisputed heavyweight champion of boxing talk radio. Talking Boxing with Billy C is on now.
My style is impetuous, my defense is impregnable, and I'm just ferocious. I want your heart.
And we're coming to you live from the Billy C Studios in Lake George, New York. I'm Bill Caligero, and it's time for Talking Boxing with Billy C. Good morning, good day, good evening, whenever you're listening or watching. Hope you're doing okay. Don't forget the show's being brought to you in part by my friends over at Katz Nationwide Luxury Transportation Service. If you need a limousine and you're someplace in the United States, you need to give my girl Kat a call, 202-351-7496. That's 202-351-7496. And tell her Billy C sent you. And, of course, my friends over at the Halftime Bar and Grill, Route 9, South Glens Falls. If you're in the Lake George, Glens Falls, Queensbury, South Glens Falls areas, you need to swing by this place, man. Completely renovated. Big screen TVs everywhere. Great people. Drink specials all the time. And, of course, the food is fantastic. Trust me, I'm a fat bastard, I know. Give them a call ahead if you want to make a reservation, 518-792-4869, or just swing by, man, 792-4869. And speaking of the Halftime Bar and Grill in South Glens Falls, beginning January 6th, when the Friday Night Fights series comes back to ESPN, we're going to be back at the Halftime Bar and Grill, giving away prizes and watching the fights with you. So make sure you mark that one down. Friday nights, beginning January 6th, come by to Halftime Bar and Grill and hang out with us, the Billy C crew. One more, man. The show's being brought to you in part by Campanero Tomkovic. That's right. A law firm that handles it all. Full service attorney firm. If you have matrimonial issues, if you have real estate issues, if you have a will you want to do, it, maybe you got some criminal issues. I don't know, man. You need a lawyer? You need Campanero Tomkovic, 845-221-4099. That's 845-221-4099. And as it is with all of our sponsors, make sure you mention Billy C for a discount. Speaking of sponsors, how about Radiosubmit.com? This week, we featured the music of Anna Popkovic, and man, she's hot. Not only is her music hot, but she's hot. And today's song, I don't know, man. This week was a tough one for me to pick, but, you know, there was a couple of good ones. Change My Mind was good earlier in the week. But I really like this one. Sitting on Top of the World was a song that we heard today. The guitar riffs in this reminded me of, and I'm not a big music guy, but it reminds me of Johnny Winter and Stevie Ray Vaughan, man. I don't know. I kind of liked it. If you're looking for information on that, Radiosubmit.com is the place to go. Anna Popkovic is the artist. Next week, we're going to be featuring the Memphis Blues. I think that's what he goes by. But some good stuff, man. So let us know what you think of that. The YouTube page is hot and heavy. Check it out, www.youtube.com/BillyCBoxing. And speaking of YouTube, if you got a guy, if you got a page and you want it to be, you know, seen, and trust me, my guy will help you out, because you know we started the YouTube thing less than 3 weeks ago, and we're almost up into the we're getting up there pretty high. All I know is we started out with like 300, and we're up near 10,000 right now. So check it out. I got a guy if you're interested in making it happen for yourself. This guy's very affordable. Drop me an email, Billy@TalkinBoxing. That's TalkinBoxing.com. We've got a busy show scheduled today. Marty Mulchaey is scheduled to join us. Talk about a couple of the fights from last week. And, of course, a handful of big fights this week. We got the Billy C Challenge going on. We picked five, so we'll be talking to Marty at least about two of them. There's some, at least two very, very, very good fights on that we'll talk about. You know, we had a poll question up on BillyCBoxing.com, and it was like, you know, we did the rankings. You know, yeah, Scotty worked on them, and some of our contributors all part of the committee. And the poll question is, you know, we went through the trouble of making up the rankings. Should we crown a champion? And I tell you, it's neck and neck. As of this morning, 57.1% of you said yes, we should crown a champion, and 42.9% of you said no. I just want to make something clear on that. We're not trying to compete with any sanctioning body because we certainly don't think that boxing needs another one. We don't need another champion. All we're talking about crowning a champion just for recognition purpose. That's it. And it's, you know, the guy who beat the guy, similar to the way the ring does their rankings. That's what we thought. Some of us here believe that we should have championships or at least a champion. And others of us here think that we should just do the top 10, who we think in each weight class. So what do you think, man? We got to make a decision, and it's pretty damn close right now. So cast your vote, BillyCBoxing.com. I got a couple of mailbags I want to talk about a little bit. First and foremost, keep the mailbags coming. We love the mailbags, and if you want to get your stuff on the air, all you got to do is send it to us. Now, I do get many, many emails a day, and if you don't, you know, a lot of people ask me my thoughts on something, or they'll bring something to my attention, or whatever the case is, and if you don't want it on, just say, this is just between us, man, or no mailbag. If you want it on the mailbag, if you want it as a mailbag, stick mailbag in the subject line, and it'll definitely get on. So, hey, speaking about getting on, how about getting on your cell phone and listen to the show? We have a mobile app. Check it out, man, if you have a Droid. Under the Marketplace, I think it is, just do a search under Sports, Billy C. Boxing, and you shall see us. So, that's that. Little announcement for you. You know, since you guys have been stumbling and bumbling and trembling with the trivia question. Three in a row, man. We stumped you three in a row. I hope you guys are feeling good about yourselves. We're gonna put that tough one aside. We got a new one today. We're going to give you guys a chance to get back on your winning ways. And speaking about getting back on winning ways, how about Arthur Abraham, King Arthur Abraham, to be exact, a former world middleweight champion. He participated in the Super Six tournament. He was a guy that I thought would win it all. He let me down. I think it was obvious that the weight, although he said he had a hard time making the 160-pound weight class limit, it seemed like he just didn't have it at all in the 168-pound weight class limit. But King Arthur Abraham is going to be back in the ring, and he's back. On January 14th, he's going to be taking on Pablo Oscar Natilio Frajas. Man, that's a land of the forename people. Pablo Oscar Natilio Frajas. Frajas, he's got to burn his Frajas. No, it's 19-1 is his record with 11 knockouts. The fight's going to be taking place in Offenburg, Germany. Where's Offenburg? Is it near Annenberg? Uh-oh. What was in the coffee today? But we'll see what's up with that. You know, this is his first fight back at middleweight. His last fight was a loss to Andre Ward. I thought he had fought one other time, but maybe an injury or something side-railed, deterred his side-railed him. I don't know. What's the word I'm looking for? Alex, hey, you know, let me just give a plug here for the new studio. It's getting close, and pretty soon we're going to open that up. And once that happens, I'm hoping that some of the contributors come on up and join me for a couple of broadcasts. We're going to have the room. We're going to have a much better set. So we're looking forward to that, and really looking forward to getting your thoughts once we open it up. I know the lighting's going to be better. It's not going to look dingy. One bad thing for yours truly is I got to actually dress. You know, right now I'm in my jammies. You know, it's like, you know, radio people, they don't have to shave. I don't even have to brush my teeth until after the show if I don't want to, you know. But, well, that's going to change. You know, all I can say is thanks, LDL TV and Fight Now. You know, I mean, these are the places that are showing us. And speaking of showing stuff, LDL TV, man, you've heard us talk about this fight for the last week. I think it should be a hot candidate for fight of the year. And, of course, I'm talking about the fights I just called out of Albuquerque, New Mexico. Fred Squad's Productions and Route 66 Casino Hotel put on a great show featuring the main event of Holly Holm against Ann Sophie Mathis. It was for not only a collection of world title belts, but also for the ranking of number one pound-for-pound female fighter in the world today. And let me tell you, this fight did not at all disappoint anyone who was there who got to see it. I know some little clips here and there have leaked out from people that have obtained them illegally with their cell phones or whatever at the event. But the whole event will be rebroadcast in its entirety tonight beginning at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. That's Friday night beginning at 8 p.m. Eastern Time on LDL TV through Ustream.com. So check out Ustream.com. And look up in the sports page. You'll see us. You could go directly to LDLTV.com and see it. It will begin at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. Then guess what? We're going to have the replay. It'll be on demand. If you miss it tonight, Friday, you can check it out beginning Saturday afternoon on BillyCBoxing.com under the Wednesday Night Fights banner. Or you can go to our YouTube page, www.youtube.com/BillyCBoxing. And watch it whenever you want. I highly recommend it, man. This is not only a great main event, but a fantastic, and I mean this, fantastic card that you do not want to miss. There is nothing else that will be on television tonight that you would want to see more than the Holly Holm and Sophie Mathis. Tune in to Ustream, 8 p.m. Eastern Time. We'll be right back.
If you're in upstate New York and you need a trucking company, then you need Roselli Enterprises. Roselli Enterprises is trucking at its finest. They have it all. Dump trucks, dump trailers, walk-in floors, flatbeds, flow boys, tankers, loaders, and a full line of roll-off containers for any job, big or small. Roselli Enterprises is also the source for all your sand, gravel, and topsoil needs. Visit them on the web at RoselliTrucking.com or call 315-433-5115. That's 315-433-5115 and tell them Billy C sent you.
Are you ready, America? Then let's get it on with Fight Now TV. It's time, fight fans. Your channel has arrived. All the fights, all the names, all the action. From world-class boxing events to mixed martial arts showdowns and other combat sports matchups, Fight Now TV delivers the hits and more. Call your television provider and tell them you want to get it on with Fight Now TV. For more details, go to fightnow.com.
We've got a great matchup tonight. Fighting out of the left corner is the number one ranked contender.
No, he is not.
I'm sorry, but who are you?
I am the IBO computer. I am programmed to provide only fair and unbiased boxing rankings. This fighter is the number 15 ranked contender.
Fair and unbiased boxing rankings? That's a new concept.
Actually, it is not. The IBO has provided unbiased computerized rankings for many years.
Well, we've still got a great fight tonight, folks. In the left corner is the number 15 ranked contender.
The IBO, the champion of integrity. Learn more at IBOboxing.com.
Check out BillyCBoxing.com now, or feel the wrath of the mighty mustache.
Oh, that hurts. Why are you doing that to my face? I hate you. I hate you.
That's BillyCBoxing.com. Consider this your warning.
And we're back. Listening to some Christmas tunes, man. It's Christmas time. That's why. You're listening to the Talking Box on Billy C Radio Show. You're watching us on LDL TV. Glad you could join us. Don't forget, man. Tonight, 8 p.m. Eastern Time. Check out the Holly Holm fight. Holly Holm and Sophie Mathis, what a fight it was. I've gotten a bunch of emails on that fight. As a matter of fact, I'm going to do a mailbag right now. But first, you know, before we get to that, I got to remind you guys about a great card that's coming up. We got some time. It's coming up February 11th at the Hershey Center in Mississauga, Ontario, Canada. And it's going to feature Young Guns. But here's why I'm talking about it now, even though it's going to be in February. If you buy tickets now, you're going to get $35 seats for $10, man, as a Christmas special. So I wouldn't be dragging my feet, especially if you plan on going to this event. Check them out. You can call for tickets, 1-888-985-5000. That's 888-985-5000. Or you can go to the Hershey Center box office directly in Mississauga, Ontario. Here's a better deal. If you're looking to get a VIP table, I'll give you an email address. Make sure you tell them Billy C sent you. And we're hoping to be up there for that unless something beyond our control prevents us. But if you're looking for a VIP table, and if you get one, I'd love to sit with you, man. So let me know. It's sales at unitedpromotions.ca. That's sales at unitedpromotions.ca for VIP tables for the February 11th Young Guns card at the Hershey Center in Mississauga, Ontario. Just tell them Billy C sent you. As promised, I got a mailbag I want to go over. We actually have a couple today. And one of them, is about the fight we were just talking about. No, not that fight in February. I'm talking about the great fight that just took place last week. Fresquez Productions put on a fantastic boxing card in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And you're going to get to see it tonight on Ustream, on LDL TV and BillyCBoxing.com. You'll be able to play it on demand whenever your heart desires, anytime after Saturday afternoon on our YouTube page, which is www.youtube.com/BillyCBoxing. Or you can see it under the Wednesday Night Fights banner at BillyCBoxing.com. I got a mailbag from, well, we call him the Other Alex, or actually he calls himself the Other Alex. You know, and he said, and it was about the Holly Holm fight. And he said, and I quote from his mailbag, he says, "I saw a clip of that Holly Holm fight. You know, incidentally, there was a lot of clips of this fight that got out, and I'll tell you the truth, totally illegal to do that. Anybody that posted a clip that we did not provide is totally illegal. As a matter of fact, Fresquez Productions put out a warning about the content. You'll see it when you watch the show tonight. That anybody that obtained video and posted it will be prosecuted." That's right. They were shaking people down. I thought that it was worse than going through an airport security. I don't know how the people got in. It was the phones, man. The phones. Yeah, you know, like the bears. It was the phones. And some people saw some clips of that made it up on YouTube. And the Other Alex said, "I saw a clip of that Holly Holm fight. The ending was disgusting. Any person who ever complains about a fight being stopped too early needs to watch this clip." You know, I just want to stop for a second, and Alex is right, man. You know, whenever we're always complaining about these referees stopping fights too soon. They need to watch this clip because it was the anti-stop in the fight too soon. And he goes on to say, "The referee nearly got that girl killed," which I said right after the fight. "I would rather see a fighter stop too soon and fight another day than to take a brutal beating, than to take that brutal beating that Holly Holm took. And for anyone who hasn't seen it, make no mistake about it. It was savage and a brutal ending. I would compare the ending of this fight to Mercer Morrison or even Cooney Norton, only there was a lot more blood involved than this one." I'm telling you, man, if you haven't seen this fight, this is almost like a promotion to rewatch the fight tonight. He goes on to say, "I don't watch women's boxing too often, and I'm not that familiar with how Holly Holm looked before the fight. But if she was pretty going in, and according to Alex, she ain't pretty no more, as they say in the Raging Bull." He says, "And what in the world was her corner waiting for? Were they just in shock because they've never seen her in a situation like that? Did they freeze under pressure? You know, what's the deal?" And he also wants to add, "Any luck getting Margaret Goodman on the show sometime?" We would love to have Margaret Goodman on. I had had her phone number because she put out a book a few years ago. And when we had the hurricane, Alex, I lost a lot of my phone numbers, because being computer savvy and all, I just never got around to putting them in the computer, so I had them on little pieces of paper that floated away. So, you know, get me a contact and I'll get a hold of her. But first of all, I tell you this, fear not. Holly Holm is just as beautiful today as she was prior to the fight. So, don't worry about that, all right? Second of all, as far as the corner comments, you know, I agree, man. They did freeze. Everyone was in shock, and I'll be honest, and let me just start off by saying, you know, I call a spade, and I admit things when I need to, and I don't admit things when I can't. But the bottom line is this, you know, I'm a little biased towards Holly Holm. I love Holly Holm, and I love her whole team. You know, the promoter, the matchmakers, the manager, the trainer, Holly, her family. I mean, it's just, you know, I love the whole Albuquerque scene. So I'm a little biased when I start talking, but I'm going to be totally and brutally honest. I think that they are in shock, Alex. And I think that the shock of watching their fighter basically be dominated and dismantled in the manner in which she was stings. And, you know, to be honest, I'm not sure that they are really viewing this fight the way they should. When you watch it, you tell me if you've seen Holly Holm fight before. You know, she's a boxer. She's a type of fighter that boxes and uses her athletic ability similar to, you know, and I'm not comparing her, but I'm just using an example, to a Sugar Ray Leonard or somebody like that, that's a boxer, you know. And Holly's corner was very quick to say she got out of her game in this fight. And that very well could be true. And when I rewatched it again yesterday, I did see that at times when I was calling the action, I was saying it live, where she should have been tying up, and instead she chose to go toe to toe. But I will tell you this: she was not 100%, and I think that her corner did her a little wrong by not dumping water on her. I think that the fight could have been stopped sooner. I think that the referee in this case was making a quick decision to try and give Holly a little extra time. Which he could have done in a different way. He didn't have to, you know, say, you know, continue fighting. The slip, which he ruled a slip, was a devastating punch. I mean, she falls flat on her face, and he calls it a slip. That was really hurtful to her, because it took her all the way until about the last. Here's a spot of the clip I want you to watch. When you rewatch the movie, after the knockdown that they call a slip, she goes back to her corner. She does the Billy C walk after two bottles of scotch back to her corner and plops down on the bench. Now, the camera happens to be on her. You don't see her face, and you don't see the close-up that I got to see of her eyes still rolled back in her head. But, you know, what you'll see almost a statue sitting there, and you'll see her corner giving her instructions and stuff. And then about 10 seconds, just immediately before the 10 seconds out, warning that they get, you know, that the rest period's almost over, you'll start to see her legs moving. You'll start to see them jittering up and down, you know, like you're pumping your legs type of a thing. That's when she started getting her faculties together, right then. All right, she started responding, at least from where I could see. All right, now, granted, I wasn't in the corner, and for all I know, she was 100% fine, but I'm just going by what it looked like to me. You watch that clip. You see how long it was before she starts acting responsive, and then what she had to do to continue the fight going into that seventh and final round. So check it out. This was a great, really, I'm not exaggerating, and wait till you see it. And, you know, Alex is correct that in this particular case, the referee made a blunder. And this is no, let me tell you something, this is no rookie referee. This is a quality referee in Rocky Burke. This guy's called many a fight. I've been ringside for his performances before as a referee, and he does a fantastic job. He had an off night. There's no question about it. And, you know, there's other ways of giving a hometown fighter some time. The best thing that I can recall and compare it to is Marlon Wright and what he did with Lucien Boutte in that fight with Lebrado Andrade. You know, I mean, bottom line is what he did. Was, you know, he gives the long count, He yells at the other corner to get back in the neutral corner. You know, the other opponent, the other fighter to get back in the neutral corner. All of this stuff. Meanwhile, you know, biding some precious seconds. You know, in hindsight, you know, and not that we want to see that, especially if you're a Sophie Ann Mathis fan. You know, that's a way to help a hometown fighter. You know, she was winning. I think going into that sixth round, she was winning every single round except for one. I think I had scored that one round for Sophie Mathis going into that sixth round. And I'm not going to mention any of the judges' names, but I talked to a couple of the judges after the fight, and two of the three judges, actually the two that I spoke to, I didn't speak to the third one, but two of the three judges I spoke to actually told me that they were scoring that a 10-8 round even with the ruling as a slip. So you know what that means. That means that that could have easily been a 10-7 round. That one round, even if Holly survives the seventh round, that one round could have been the telltale. All I know is this. Watch the fight. It'll be available tonight, 8 p.m. Eastern time on LDL TV, Ustream, and then on demand on YouTube.com/BillyCBoxing beginning Saturday afternoon, and of course on BillyCBoxing.com. Hey, we got to take a break. We'll be right back.
The holidays mean one thing in the world of sports, lots of college football, 70 teams and 35 bowl games. Where did it all start? That's next on Sports Shorts with me, the Sports Princess.
This Your Family Today tip is brought to you by Tombstone Pizza. With multiple varieties to choose from, there's a Tombstone Pizza that's sure to please your family. What do you want on your tombstone? Family dinner is important, but who says it has to be at the table? When life gets busy and the pressure is on, pull out the good paper plates and settle in for pizza and a movie. It's fun, easy, and memorable for the whole family. For more tips like these, visit us at parenthood.com/yourfamilytoday.
The first of the games of the season, December 17th, the New Mexico Bowl pits Temple against Wyoming. Then my alma mater, Ohio, will take on Utah State and Boise, Idaho. The first ever bowl game took place in 1902. Michigan beat Stanford 49-0 in the Rose Bowl. In fact, the use of the word bowl comes from that stadium in Anaheim. Why? Because it's shaped like a bowl. By the 30s, you had the Rose, Cotton, Orange, and Sugar Bowls. Fast forward to 98 and the formation of the Bowl Championship Series formed by the NCAA to crown a true college champ. But over the years, there's been plenty of controversy on whether you truly always get the best two teams vying to be crowned number one. There's been an outcry for a playoff system among many college football fans. Until then, all the eyes of the world will be on New Orleans January 9th when LSU and Alabama meet in the championship game. I'm the Sports Princess with Sports Shorts.
And we're back. You are listening to the Talking Boxing with Billy C. Radio Show. And you're also listening to some Christmas music, Twisted Sister, Let It Snow. And you're also watching us on the Fight Now channel. That's right. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, combat sports. It's here right now, and it's called Fight Now. I want to welcome the Fight Now audience that's just joining us. And I want to remind all you guys that are watching the show on Fight Now that you're going to get to see a great fight tomorrow night. Exclusively on Fight Now here in the United States, and that's going to be the David Lemieux. That's right, the David Lemieux fight against. You know what? I'm gonna try my best at saying this guy's name right. It's Joseem Alsine. Joseem Alsine. It's going to be on Fight Now Saturday night. So make sure you check the website for all the information about that. www.fightnow.com. But speaking of now. My man from Max Boxing, the man, the myth, the legend himself, Marty Mulcahy.
You know, I'm sorry, training is part of the fight as far as I'm concerned. And if you lack in that fundamental aspect, you deserve to lose. End of story. When you come to my town, you're going to lose no matter what you do.
Who does it better than Marty Mulcahy? Nobody I know, and joining us right now is Marty Mulcahy. What's up, brother?
Good morning. Doing well, doing well.
Hey, I tell you something. You know, we got that great fight, the Holly Holm fight. You got to check it out. I know you haven't seen it yet, but it's going to be replayed tonight. So if you get a chance, definitely watch that one, man. It's going to be a good one.
I saw the ending on YouTube because, as usual, I got that fight wrong on the Ability Challenge because it's a woman's fight. I've yet to get one of those right.
Hey, I got that wrong.
I saw the ending. How brutal.
Yeah, you know, I tell you, I don't know how they put that up because
somebody did. Yeah, I saw it on YouTube.
Yeah, nobody was allowed to. I mean, you know, with the footage and all of that. But we're gonna have the whole fight up there. And I think they showed it from the time she was tangled up in the ropes, right?
No, they showed like various clips throughout the round, like, you know, little 10-second clip, and then, you know, I think like the last 30 seconds of the ending. And yeah, they just showed the tangle up with the referee, helped her get out of the ropes, and then the ending.
Yeah, but, you know, the referee helps her get off the ropes, then he leaves her leaning there, and I was right there. I mean, that's where I was sitting, and I looked up and... I'm sorry.
Yeah, I thought that should have been. He should have gave her a standing eight count there. Now that, even if they don't have the standing eight count rule, the ropes held her up, so he should have allowed her to get up and then give her the 10 count, pretty much, you know, another count.
Well,
so she can clear her head. And by rules, it should have been scored a knockdown.
Well, that's the thing. Usually when a fighter's leaning against the ropes like that, especially when they're tangled up, and she took at least 4, 5, 6 shots while she was defenseless there, he at least makes...
It was almost like the Tommy Morrison knockout. When Tommy Morrison got knocked out against, here we go again, I'm blanking on the name, against Ray Mercer.
Right, and I just read an email of a mailbag that referred to that fight. But the thing was, is that if most of the time, as a matter of fact, I thought it was a rule, to be honest with you, when the ropes are holding you up, the referee should have said, okay, take a step forward, make her take a step away from the ropes. And she would have fell flat on her face because she was out. She was out. You know, she could, you know, and that was a shame. But anyway, we'll be able to...
Yeah, the other fight, I guess you can compare that to is when, you know, when Burke Cooper knocked Evander Holyfield into the ropes, and, you know, pretty much didn't get the knockdown score there.
Well, I mean, we actually had a fight against, Chevelle Halbach had a fight against Holly Holm that we thought we should have gotten a knockdown, and that one in the ropes held her up, but this was totally different. She was just... you know, stunned a little from Halbach, but this was bad. But anyway, we'll get to watch that tonight. Here's the thing. I just wanted to ask you a couple of thoughts real quick before we get into a few fights and then some other issues. There's so many things I want to talk to you about. First and foremost, Robin Helenius, everybody jumped on a bandwagon with this guy. And, you know, it's typical. Even if his opponent, Derek Chisora, was regarded as a guy that was a legitimate title challenger or anything else until he laid his egg against Tyson Fury. Now, all of a sudden, he was regarded as nothing until he steps in with Helenius. And, I mean, for all intents and purposes, Helenius got a hometown decision. I mean, most people think Chisora won every round.
Yeah, I thought he got a hometown decision as well. As far as the reputation of Chisora, I mean, this is boxing. So you're as good as your last fight. So right now, Chisora's riding high. He's going to get another good fight out of this. I tend to believe Helenius when he says that he hurt his right hand. I thought he did rock Chisora with one punch. He didn't continuously hurt him, as he said in the post-fight interview. I thought he did rock him a little bit with one punch and was supposedly he hurt his hand. You know, I give everybody the benefit of the doubt, and you can have one off day, one bad performance, and this is definitely a bad performance. He just never got the right distance in the fight. He allowed Chisora to pressure him and choose the point of engagement, and it wasn't held on the outside where it should have been, where he had the length, where he had the reach, where he used accuracy, and Chisora, for me, just won that fight on activity and effective aggressiveness. He was the one coming forward. He was the one landing. He was forcing the engagement. If it was up to Helenius, that fight would have been fought at the center of the ring with him coming forward. It was the opposite. It was Chisora using his bulk and his upper body strength. So it was his obviousness. Right? He had much more upper body strength than Helenius. That is the one aspect where I think he needs to get, I don't know how he can do it, but he needs to get stronger as far as physically stronger. He's a good puncher because of his balance, and he really puts everything into his punches. He leans into it well, but I don't think he has that brute stopping power. He's just more of an accurate puncher, and he's really well-balanced. So this is just a bad fight, and I think you judge him off, you know, how he comes back from this, you know. And also, give him credit for, he is challenging himself. He hasn't had 20 fights yet. He already, you know, went through some really good opposition, considering he's not yet reached his 20th fight. They really pushed their heavyweights quickly in the challenging matchups over in Europe, and it showed here. As much as the egg he laid against Tyson Fury, which he definitely did, he's a borderline top 15 heavyweight. He's gonna give everybody problems. And even in a Tyson Fury fight, he gave him problems in the first. You know, he just wasn't in shape to do a contingency as he did with Elenia. So I think if Chisora comes in at 100% shape for his fight, he challenges anyone.
Yeah, no, and he hurt Tyson Fury. Tyson Fury hung on in that fight.
Definitely. That was a really underrated fight. It was really good for the people, you know, who punked down the money to see that fight. They got their money for it.
For both sides, actually. You know, a Chisora that didn't train and you know, went the distance, and then a Tyson Fury who showed some heart after he was rocked. But the other fight on that card, Povetkin and Boswell, I don't think it's really a shocker. You know, Boswell is just was a guy that was hand-fed tomato cans for this opportunity, you know, a title shot, which I think is a complete joke. But I'm still stuck on the Povetkin. I do not see
a title shot, because you can't really call Povetkin a world champion.
No, but they do.
They do.
And it's sickening that they do. And it's sickening that Teddy Atlas brags that he's got a world champion now, too. You know, when he was so vocal about the lack of value until his guy got it. And that's my hang-up. You know, I honestly do not see any improvement with Povetkin. What's your thoughts?
Improvement, no, but he is the finished product right now. I mean, people have to remember, he's one of the last Soviet fighters, you know, to come out of that old Russian system who went through that rigorous amateur system that they had. Now, you know, it's pretty much split up. A lot of the trainers have gone into different directions. They don't have a central camp anymore. And he's one of the last ones to come through there. And, my God, he was in the amateur ranks. He was just, when he, in the Olympics, nobody came within 12 points of him. He was just that head and shoulders above everyone. So I think he is the finished product right now. And it's just they're in a holding pattern until they get to one of the Klitschkos. I think it was impressive that he stopped his opponent, but, you know, I think the outcome was a given. It was how he was going to end the fight. And he did end the fight impressively. At no point was he pressed. At no point did, you know, the thighs come into factor, which is always kind of iffy with him because he's not the tallest of heavyweights. So he relies on movement, on timing, and he showed both of that in the fight. And I think, you know, Teddy Atlas is a good trainer, and I think he's the type of trainer he needs right now, because he's got everything physically. He just needs to be motivated mentally. And I just hope that the language barrier isn't too much of a problem there, and that he is motivating him properly. Because, well, like I said, I really don't know what else he can do to Povetkin to make him he's already an instinctual fighter. He has every punch in the book. It's just about putting it all together and then come out with the right game plan. So when he gets to a Klitschko, he has to have, you know, A, B, and C game plan. He can't just rely on one and hope it gets him through.
Yeah, well, he needs to rely on more than a game plan when he gets in with Klitschko. But Miguel Cotto, Antonio Margarito, you know, listen, it was a fantastic performance by Cotto. I thought that Antonio Margarito, according to my scorecards, I didn't give one round to him at the time of the stoppage. I also noted that I thought his eye was completely shut by the sixth round. I thought the New York State Athletic Commission gave him every opportunity to finish the fight. The only thing, the only negative I see with Cotto is that he did seem to start running out of gas again right around the ninth, tenth round. And, you know, who knows if Margarito's eye didn't shut down by the sixth round, you know, maybe we would have saw something similar to what we saw the first time. What do you think?
No, I don't think so. That was a really challenging style that he gave himself there. Well, let's get some training, some some credit to Miguel Cotto's new trainer. His name is losing right now, Pepe something, who came over from the Cuban. He trained all these Cuban amateurs. Wigando, all these Cubans that you're seeing right now, he was a big factor in getting these guys to where they are right now, as good as they are. Remember, he was the top trainer in that Cuban amateur system, the Solis, that featherweight. The man that you're so high on, and you love him.
Which guy? What featherweight? Featherweight? Yuriorkis Gamboa?
Gamboa, there you go. Yeah. Oh. I mean, he had a part in all of these fighters. So let's give him some credit, because this is a Cotto that we've seen in spurts before, but not for four, five, six rounds in a row. I mean, he was using his legs, he was backing up, he was getting the right distance, he was avoiding shots, he showed some really good defensive reflexes in here. I was more impressed with his defense than his offense, actually, in this fight, and I haven't been able to say that about Cotto since his first three, 4 years as a pro. I mean, he really kind of reverted from an all-around fighter at the beginning of his career to more of a slugger and a dominating come-forward guy. And here we saw, a little bit of his earlier career, and I was really impressed. There was nothing that Cotto did not do in this fight. And even when he did take a solid punch, he rode with it. He saw it coming, and, he either rode with the punch or ducked at the right time and had made it a glancing blow. And as far as running out of steam towards the end, I think he had the fight in the bag, and he would have got a second win in this fight. He wasn't taking enough damage throughout the first 10 rounds to really put him out of the fight in the last two rounds. So yeah, I think everything was positive in this fight, just all around. It's good for Cotto, and I'm so happy that he won the fight, because I think it pretty much shows, the lack of facial damage that you saw in this fight. I believe shows that Margarito did wear those same draps he tried to wear against Shane Mosley. And he looked at the previous three fights. I posted on my Facebook page that the three fights before the main event, I have a hard time remembering so much blood and facial swelling in the undercard fights. I mean, you look at Wolak, you look at what happened to Murray, their faces were just completely torn apart in those fights.
Yeah, well, let's talk about Bam Bam Rios against John Murray. This fight is why I love Bam Bam Rios so much. Here's a guy that clearly had trouble making weight. He was weak going into the fight, took way too many punches in the early onset, wore his opponent down, and then, knocks him out dramatically in the 11th round. The fight is stopped. What's your thoughts on Bam Bam Rios? We know he's moving up to junior welter. He lost his titles on the scale. What do you think, man?
Yeah, he has to move up. I don't think he can wait around for the Gamboa fight. I think he had some problems with the weight because he was coming from California to New York. You have a whole climate switch there, and the flight, I think that could play a little bit into it. So it's not a reason to give him a pass, but he's obviously having to come down he's having to drop like 30 pounds to get into the ring, and that is just way too much. Junior welterweight is where he needs to be. But you're right. This is why we love him. He's like that locomotive. The first two, three rounds, you better get his reset and you better show some kind of jab in order to keep in front of him and to make sure that he stays off you. Because once he gets going, and if you're in those training tracks, he's just going to run you over.
Yeah. Now, Paulie Wolak, Delvin Rodriguez, strange stuff. Delvin Rodriguez did exactly what he was supposed to do in the first fight this time. And I totally believe that Delvin Rodriguez has found his comfortable weight. I mean, he looks like a different fighter. 2 points I want to make. Number one, I actually find myself agreeing with Max Kellerman a couple times that night, and he said that, sometimes Delvin Rodriguez looks like he's tired, looks like he's not performing the way he should at the end of fights, and that could be the reason why he's losing these close decisions, and I kind of agree with him there. The other thing is, Paulie Wolak was apparently so disgusted with his performance, he retired. So what do you think of the fight, Delvin Rodriguez, and Wolak's retirement announcement?
I'll address the retirement announcement first. When it comes, like, within a week of the fight, you always, kind of push that to the side. It's emotional, and a loss like that is emotional. So I believe him for now, and I kind of hope he does stay retired, because those last two fights, he took a lot of punches. The actual fight, all credit to Delvin Rodriguez. Once again, I picked Wolak. I thought that he was the bigger man. I thought he'd be more effective, but he could just never get inside of Rodriguez's punches. He was always at the end of his punches, and the footwork of Rodriguez is what won him this fight. He kept circling. Wolak couldn't cut off the ring, and because he was a faster fighter, he was able to use his fist more and just rack up the points, and all credit to him. Like I said, I picked against him. Yeah. Twice, and twice he proved me wrong. All credit to Rodriguez. I thought at some point he was going to get caught like he did in previous fights and go down, and that never happened to him. You're right. Maybe it is the weight.
You know, it's funny. Every time I pick against him, I lose too. But, you know, the Mike Jones fight it was a sweet science display from Mike Jones. It just, you know, it was a little boring. I just want to touch base real quick on two fights from Showtime. Number one, Victor Chinian against Emilio Marino. Victor Chinian, I was so glad that he admitted that he won that he lost the fight, could.
That's the most surprising thing about it. That, forget everything else.
When
Nonito Zanero knocked him out, he was saying, you know, like, what? I'm fine. Why didn't you let me keep fighting?
I know.
You know? Was the most impressive thing. I mean, I did pick Moreno to win the fight in the Billy Sue Challenge. I thought that if there was going to be problems, it was going to be late in the fight with Chinian's pressure, but. The style was beautiful. I mean, he stayed in the pocket. He did not run from Darchinian's power. He gave him angles. He was within punching range. So, yeah, a lot of credit there. I don't know if he can do that against Abner Meares. He's more of a volume puncher and he's a more accurate puncher. But, whew, yeah, he proved he was for real against Darchinian here. This is a very good result. And style-wise, it was also a very good result. He was not just a runner. He was in the throwing his punches and evading the other one. That's the sweet science right there.
You know, speaking of Marius, he showed me a lot against King Kong Igbeko. He showed me that he's the full deal, man. He's the full package. He can box, he can bang, he's got decent defensive skills. He knows all the tricks. He can hit below the belt. He can hit the kidneys behind the head. He can do it all. I respect him a lot, all kidding aside. I think he's a talented fighter. Two things. Number one, getting back to Marino, I think Marino should fight Abner Meares. He's calling out Jorge Arce right now, which is a similar style to Victor Chinian, in a sense where the defensive skill of Marino will do the same to Jorge Arce that he did to Victor Chinian. But Abner Meares brings a little more to the table, and I think that's the fight. I want your thoughts on that. And the other thing I want to mention about Agbeko, you know, as far as I'm concerned, Agbeko gave the fight to Maris because he didn't throw enough punches, and he wasn't throwing the right punch. He just abandoned his patented right hand, and he tried, just like he did in the first fight, to land a left hook that he's just been working on. You know, I had said that it's too bad that he didn't learn more of the sweet science earlier on, but, you know, it's a little too late to teach an old dog new tricks.
Yeah, but he did land those punches in the first fight. You know, they were just kind of he was in that first fight. And because of all the low blows, people, you know, remember the controversy. They don't remember that Agbeko was really close on the cards. And that final punch to the groin, where, you know, it was ruled a knockdown, pretty much on the judges' cards, lost in the fight. He could have had a draw. I think you have to go back to Maurer and give him the credit on this. And you're right, he is the complete package. He is a better defensive boxer than you know, he could beat them with that on defense, but he lets offense comes first with him. This is a guy who, at the beginning of his career, was trained by Nacho Beristain, you know, the guy that you know, brought the Marquez brothers to the prominence. And you have to be an all-around fighter to you know, survive in that Romanzo gym of his. So, yeah, Mahrez, he is the total package. And you're right, I think that him and Moreno is the fight that Showtime should make. I think Moreno really established himself as the top of, you know, near the top of the Bantamweight division with Nonito Donaire. And him calling out Arce.
I just lost you, Marty. If you could give us a shout back, Marty. You know, this damn phone system. I took about losing him abruptly. You know, let's just hope that he gives us a call back quickly, and because I don't want to miss his thoughts on this. But, you know, I agree with what he was starting to say, that the fight really that we would love to see at this stage of the game, especially on the heels of this whole tournament that they had, so to speak, is to have Abner Marriott fight Emilio Moreno. And we got Marty back on the line. Well, what happened over there in Colorado?
You're the one, you're the serial offender here as far as the phone line is concerned. So this falls on you again.
Well, I kind of finished that up because I don't want to run out of time. I don't want to lose you. We got a couple of really good fights this weekend, a couple really good. And the first one I wanted to ask you about is a sleeper fight, Gennady Golovkin against Luan Simon. I say it's a sleeper fight because Gennady Golovkin, yes, he's a world champion, but really when I look through and looked closely at his resume, his opponent in Luan Simon very well might be the toughest guy he's faced to date.
Yeah, it could be. He's not a world champion. We went through this with Povetkin. I mean, as close as his fights have been in the last 2 years or whatever, but Felix Sturm is the real WBA champion. He only has, you know, a belt, a title. But getting to the fight, Gennady, man, this guy's for real. I mean, this is a guy who reportedly ran Julio Cesar Chavez out of the ring in sparring sessions and just has got a really good, solid reputation over here on the West Coast as far as a sparring partner. If you're in between 154 and 158 and you want good sparring, this is the guy you go and get. Another guy has come out of the Russian amateur system, but not the one I was referring to in Povetkin. Just an all-around pressure fighter. He's a straight-ahead banger. And in his last fight, he took out Kasim Uma, who's a little bit like Luan Simon in that he's a good boxer, a good volume guy, but he just doesn't have the stopping power, the punching power to wear somebody like Golovkin down. So I would have think Golovkin at home, he's going to tear through Luan Simon. I don't know if he can stop him because he can't take a punch. And the reason that Simon is back in Germany, they're having this fight in Germany, because he went with Arthur Abraham. He went 12 rounds with him in Germany and Sylvester as well. So he's a known product over there. And if Golovkin can get a stoppage here, that's really going to be a real good step in his resume. Because both Arthur Abraham and Sylvester were not able to stop Simon.
You know, the fight of the weekend, I think, and I'm really excited that we're going to be able to see it here in the States, is Giovanni Segura against Brian Valoria. This kid, I can't tell you how much I love Giovanni Segura. And, you know, a small guy, packs a powerful punch. You know, Cancilla was his only blemish on his record. He avenged that loss. What's your thoughts of this fight?
I think it's a really good fight. Me and Brian Valoria have this history where every time I think he's coming around and he's going to be a champion of worth and stick around for a while, he disappoints me. I mean, this guy, going back to the Olympics, I remember seeing him in Colorado Springs in the Olympic trials and seeing him saying, this guy's going to win the Val Baker Trophy in 2000 for the best amateur boxer in the Olympics. That's how highly I thought of him. He let me down there. He didn't even make it to the medal round. And then as a champion, when he finally won his first strap, I said, man, all right, he's a champion. He's going to stay now. And then what does he do? He loses a fight to Omar Romero, and then he loses to Edgar Sosa. And then I'm ready to bury him, say, okay, he's done. He's not going to, you know, I overrated him. You know, let's move on. Then he goes and wins the title against Ulysses Feliz, and I'm like, okay, I'm back on the bandwagon. What's he do? Next fight, he loses it. So up and down. And every time I think he's there, he disappoints me. Every time I give up on him, he shows me wrong. So I'm ready to give up on him. I think Giovanni Segura is going to beat him. He's just got too much power. He's going to be pushing him backwards, and if the judging is the way I expect it to be in the Philippines, it's fair, and that they appreciate offense a little bit more than defense, I think it's going to give the effective aggressiveness to Segura and reward that and give him a decision. But like I said, every time I'm ready to write off the lawyer, he comes back and proves me wrong. And Segura, you mentioned the Cancilla loss. The reason he lost that was he couldn't corner. He couldn't get to Cancilla, and he was just pot-shotted and low combinations and moving on, and he couldn't get to him. And remember, Cancilla was also a really late replacement, so that played a little factor into it as well. But it's movement that can give Segura problems, but I think he solved that against Ivan Calderon, who was a classic mover. So I think he's rounded into the complete package. And he's a little bit like Rios Armando Rios. He's a little bit like him. But if you can't get out of his way, you're doomed. You have to find a way to get out of his way and effectively counter him. You have to really be strong mentally to be accepting of those punches and ride him out and come back with combinations of your own. You cannot let him establish a rhythm. And that's what Veloria is good at. So style-wise, I think it favors Veloria, but I just can't trust him anymore. I think Segura is the complete package. He's rounding into him. He's coming into his prime, where I think Veloria just left his prime, and that's another reason I'm going with Segura.
The fight on HBO, I mean, I did not include the Seth Mitchell, Taimur Abragimov fight on the challenge. You know, I'm not impressed with Seth Mitchell, and Taimur Abragimov is not like his brother. So you know, and quite
his
honestly,
brother isn't all that great.
Yeah. Well, neither is Taimur. You know. Yeah. So I, you know what? And I missed it. I had already sent it up to Simon, and I didn't want to make a big deal about it. And I, you know, I'm just not. I just don't have this warm, fuzzy feeling about Seth Mitchell. I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's not worth putting extra work in.
No.
I'm coming around on Seth Mitchell. I think he's shown a lot of improvement. I've never been high on these athletes who come to boxing as a second choice in their original sport. But just in general, when prices hit, when things aren't going their way anymore, they don't have the muscle memory or just the experience to fall back on to help them get over the rocky patches. And that's always been a problem with these guys.
Amir Khan, Lamont, you dummy, Peterson. You know,
I wonder how many people get that reference.
I'm
a big Sapper fan. I help a lot of people get that reference.
I can't help it. Every time I say the name, it just comes out, you know. And I know a lot of people probably don't know what the hell I'm talking about. And I've had to even say I'm not calling Lamont Peterson a dummy, you know. But anyway, you know, I feel a little bit for Lamont Peterson because I think he's a talented fighter. I think he's a very talented fighter. And all of a sudden, he's got this label of an opponent. And I'm going to break it down a little later. But he's stepping in with Amir Khan. I would think if it was anyone else, it would be hard to pick against Peterson. But how do you pick against Amir Khan when this guy just seems to be getting better and better and better?
And the thing is, these guys are a mirror image of each other. But everything that Lamont Peterson does, Amir Khan does just a little bit better. I mean, he's just one inch taller. He's just got like a probably an inch more reach on him. Everything that Peterson is, Khan is like times two, is what it comes down to. And you're right, Lamont Peterson is a really, really good boxer. The thing is, he doesn't have that one overwhelming facet to make him a really champion, is what I believe. He does everything well, but nothing great. And that came out in the Timothy Bradley fight, where he fought back, you know. He was put down in the second or third round. He was put down hard, and he got up from that. And he was really getting his head handed to him, but he stuck with it. You know, he kept fighting back. He lost every round, but every round was close. He made it fun to watch, even though it was not that competitive. And the Victor Ortiz fight is another one where he had to rally. And you gain an appreciation for a fighter who won't quit. And Lamont Peterson has no quit in him, but he also doesn't have that one big punch or that great speed or great sense of distance to really put him over the edge where he can be a world champion. He just does every. I think he's going to be if he sticks with it, I think he'll be a great trainer, you know, down the road. So he does everything well and he sees everything well. Just that he needs that one extra, you know, nanosecond of speed, something. Just he doesn't have that one factor to make him a champion.
You know, David Lemieux is taking on Joseph Alcein tomorrow night on Fight Now out of Montreal. And, you know, I got to give Lemieux credit because this is not Alcine's not an easy opponent, you know, and quite honestly, you know, the toughest opponent that Lemieux has had is his last fight against Marco Antonio Rubio, and we all know how that turned out. What's your thoughts on this one real quick? Oh, you don't say, Marty. Well, Marty, we lost you. I know his time was up anyway. So, Marty, have a great weekend, and see you later. You know, so, you know, I would want him to call back, but, you know, two disconnects in a matter of a couple of minutes here is sucks, if you ask me. But anyway, hey, listen, I'm going to take a break, and when I come back, we'll be talking boxing. You think that's what we're going to talk about?
Are you ready, America? Then let's get it on with Fight Now TV. It's time, fight fans. Your channel has arrived. All the fights, all the names, all the action. From world-class boxing events to mixed martial arts showdowns and other combat sports matchups, Fight Now TV delivers the hits and more. Call your television provider and tell them you want to get it on with Fight Now TV. For more details, go to fightnow.com.
Hey, fight fans, check out KOFantasyBoxing.com. KO Fantasy Boxing is boxing's only trademarked fantasy game. Check it out, www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. Select your own gym, your own fighters, track them through a season that can last from 3 months to a year, depending upon which league you join. You got to check this out, man. www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. Join it today. Again, www.KOFantasyBoxing.com. And tell them Billy C sent ya. And we're back. You're listening to Elvis. Elvis's version of Blue Christmas here on the Talking Boxing with Billy C radio show. It's Christmas time, so we're playing some Christmas tunes. You're also watching us live on Fight Now. That's right. The Fight Now channel airs us live every single day, Monday through Friday, from 6 to 7:30 a.m. So if you have the channel and you're listening to the show, tune in and watch it, man. If you don't have the channel, now's your chance to call your local television provider and tell them that you want the Fight Now channel added to your lineup. And I'll tell you what, today's a great day to do it because Fight Now will be offering that exact fight I just asked Marty about, David Lemieux against Josie Malsain, which is taking place Saturday night from Montreal. You know, you'll be able to watch it right on Fight Now. For all the information about that show and their other lineups, all the rest of the stuff we got going on Fight Now, visit their website, www.fightnow.com. But the most important thing, I should say, hey, you know what? There's only one thing. The most important thing is, wrong time. But, I was going to say, you know, the most important thing is that you call your local television provider right now and tell them that you want the Fight Now channel. That's right. Add it to your lineup. You know, that's what you got to do. But, anyway. Some fights that we're not going to be covering this week on the Billy C Challenge is a fight that I'm a little disappointed. Last minute sub has come in, and I pulled him from the I pulled it from the Billy C Challenge. Ashley Theophane is defending his British junior welterweight title tomorrow night, Saturday night, and they had to throw in a last minute sub Murphy. No, not our Murphy, another Murphy. But, Ashley Theophane, this guy can't get a cut a break, but he's the real deal. So we'll have to look forward to his next outing, I guess. But don't look past your opponents. Hey, speaking about not looking past, we got a couple of comebacks going on this weekend as well. Jermaine Taylor, as far as I know, is making his comeback tomorrow night, as well as Andre Durrell. So we got a couple of guys that are very questionable with should they return. And both of them are making their return on the same card. At least they were, as far as I know, tomorrow night. So we'll have to wait and see what happens there. But anyway, there's another fight. And this was a fight that we actually had on our challenge. And then I realized it was rescheduled. I think it's a bit of a joke. Brian Minto and Tony TNT Grano are going to be fighting each other for some title. I believe it's the NABF elimination bout or something like that. I don't know. But listen, here's the deal. Tony Grano is kind of a joke. He's a joke. And Brian Minto is just a really tough guy. I'm telling you right now, Team Grano probably thinks that this fight is for them. And the fact that it's taking place at a location I'm not going to mention, because unless we're involved with them, I would say, you know, don't go anywhere near this place. But where it's going to be, you would think Tony Grano is a lot closer to it than Brian Minto. So they're probably thinking that he's going to bring some fans. But I got news for you. There's not many people that think Tony Grano is anything, and I wouldn't be surprised if Brian Minto knocks him out on January 28th, so we'll have to wait and see on that one. You know, one of the things I wanted to ask my man Marty was what he thought about the International Boxing Hall of Fame inductees this year. But anyway, you know, speaking of Canada, and yes, you can watch that great show coming out of Montreal on Fight Now tomorrow night, but Interbox announced that their junior welterweight champion, the Intercontinental champ, everybody's a friggin' champion these days, but their undefeated junior welterweight prospect, let's call him that, or contender at least, he's 18-0, Pierre Oliver Cote, is going to be taking his undefeated record and putting it on the line against Mauricio Herrera, who's only been once beaten. You know, not to be confused with once bitten, but no, he's been once beaten. His record is 18-1 with 7 knockouts. It's taking place on February 3rd, and it's going to be on Showbox, the new generation. So it's going to be coming at us from Quebec in Canada. You know how many shows are coming at us from Canada? You know, we got one next week. We got one this weekend on Fight Now. We got one next weekend coming up. We got a couple in January. We got two in February. I mean, Canada, is anybody busier than Canada with fights? You know, I was talking about David Lemieux, who's fighting tomorrow night on Fight Now. His nemesis, the guy who put the blemish on his record, Marco Antonio Rubio, he's going to be fighting too. And he's going to be fighting next week, December 16th. At the WBC convention. You know, well, you got some drunk plumbers going after the prostitutes. Well, the people at the WBC convention, they're going to be doing some business with them, too. No, this is just me saying that. I'm not saying it's for fact. I'm just saying it's probably what I would do. But Marco Antonio Rubio, that is, will be taking on Matt Vanda. Matt Vanda's not a bad fight. I like this matchup, man. Matt Vanda against Marco Antonio Rubio, pretty good fight. We'll see how Rubio does. He's been on a tear of late. And speaking about being on a tear, how about Bob Arum, who turned 80 years old? 80 years old. You know, the two main guys that have been promoting for the last 20, 30 years are both 80 years old, man. Don King and now Bob Arum. And I tell you what I'll say about Bob Arum is this guy's not slowing down. I mean, you know, Don is slowing down a bit. Don is definitely slowing down a bit. There's no question about that. But Bob Arum isn't. Bob Arum is, you know, geez. You know, and as a matter of fact, when asked if he plans on, you know, taking it easy a little bit, he says, what are you kidding me? It's he says, Top Rank is just getting bigger and better. He said that we're going to have, going into next year, he's talking about 2012 now. He says we're going to have more shows, more sponsors. Whatever you saw this year won't compare to what we got in store for you this year coming up. Now, I heard him just say this on an interview, and I guess that's his line when everybody asks what's going on, because he said it again the other night. So, we also we have that fight that we mentioned, the Gennady Golovkin and Luan Simon. Well, it was announced yesterday that, you know, there's going to be another belt on the line. Right now, the WBA World Middleweight title belongs to Golovkin, but apparently it was announced yesterday that the vacant IBO World Middleweight title is on the line, and the winner of this fight will become the new IBO and WBA World Middleweight champion. So, you know what? You know how I feel about the IBO. I just hope that, you know, both fighters are worthy
of all those titles. That's all. But anyway, speaking of worthy fighters, Sergey Lakayevich and Eddie Chambers are going to be kicking off that new boxing series. Now, it's called NBC Sports Network. Now, I got to give Main Events and you know, everybody else involved with this whole project credit, because NBC Sports Network, doesn't it make you think that it's NBC, the National Broadcasting Company? But actually, it's Diverse's network, and they're renaming it the NBC Sports Network. Now, I'm pretty sure that NBC has taken over Versus. I'm not 100% sure, but as of January 2nd, it will now be called, Versus will now be called the NBC Sports Network. And the Main Events and promoter Main Events, Kathy Duva, had signed, we talked about this a month or so ago, had signed a deal to bring some fights, a whole series, and it's going to kick off on January 21st from Philadelphia with a really, really decent matchup in the heavyweight division. Eddie Chambers, 36 wins, 2 losses, 18 coming by knockout, will be taking on Sergey Lakayevich, who's 25-4, in the main event. It's going to be a 10-round fight. Personally, you know, Lakayevich, you know, is trying to get back on track. And Eddie Chambers, he's got a lot to prove to me. I think Eddie Chambers is done. You know, I think that knockout to Klitschko ruined him. He came back with a struggle with Derek Rossi, who's been knocked out twice since then. The thing is that Chambers is too small for a heavyweight. Although I thought that he was exciting when he was, I'm going to say in his prime, even though I'm not saying he's old and over the hill. I just think that fight against Klitschko really took its toll on Eddie Chambers. I think Eddie Chambers should lose the love handles, man, and fight a cruiserweight. He could own the cruiserweight division, but he and his team have become very lazy. I'm shocked that they're fighting this fight, because typically they're only looking for world title fights. But let's face it, Chambers has to beat somebody in order to get another shot. And Lakayevich, according to Chambers' team, is that guy. But I got news for you. This is going to be a tough fight for Chambers, because, like I said, I'm one that thinks he's seen better days. The co-main event is pretty good, too, because who's going to be on the co-main event? How about Gabriel Rosado, who's 18-5 out of Philadelphia, is taking on Jesus Soto Carras, who is, I love watching this kid fight, 24 wins, 6 losses, and 3 draws. Very evenly matched fight. Kudos to Kathy Duva and Main Events, kicking off this series with a pair of really cool fights. And talk about ESPN-level fights. Both of these fights are right there with ESPN the way they were this year, which I thought was the best year for ESPN since they've been in business. But the bottom line is we'll see how this works out. And it's starting on January 21st. Another big card that you'll be able to see tonight is the Brian Valoria. I'm sorry, tomorrow night is the Brian Valoria and Giovanni Segura fight. It's going to be live on pay-per-view. You could check out, I know the Dish Network has it, and some of the other television vehicles, I don't know, outlets. Yeah. Thank you. The other television outlets have it. You could check out the website, www.integratedsportsnet.com, for all the information on how you can check out this fight. What a great one. It's going to be 8 p.m. Eastern Time is when the action will start for this one. You know, I just hope that Integrated Sports Net is going to be able to somehow get it on Time Warner so I can watch it, man. I got to be honest. I don't like watching the feeds, man, on a computer, even though I'm all for computers, of course. But, you know, I'm not all for watching. I like sitting in front of my television, and, you know, I got the old set. I don't have anything new. I'm not like you guys. I don't have any money. I can't afford a big screen, high-definition TV where I could sit back and, you know, feel like I'm in the ring. I'm watching it on a rabbit ears black and white, if you believe that. But David Lemieux against Josim Althine. Is going to be taking place tomorrow night from Montreal, and you can check that out on Fight Now. So we've got a bunch of things going on that's all in the positive realm for tomorrow night and the sport of boxing, that's for sure. Also, one last thing. Listen, if you missed it,
Don't forget, tonight we're rebroadcasting that fantastic fight card from Albuquerque, New Mexico. It took place last week on Ustream. Check it out, Ustream.com. Tonight beginning at 8 p.m. Eastern Time, LDLTV.com, 8 p.m. Eastern Time. And then after that, you'll be able to play the whole card on demand by visiting the Wednesday night fight section at BillyCBoxing.com or YouTube.com/BillyCBoxing anytime on Saturday and beyond. You'll be able to watch it. Definitely mark that one down and check it out. You will not regret it. I got another mailbag I want to read. This one's from Leon Taylor. And Taylor is from East London, England. Yeah. You know, we're invaded by the Europeans on this show, and no one loves the Europeans more than me because they are the most interactive and loyal listeners we have. And I want to thank all of you right now, except for David Allen. But he says, and I quote, "Hey, Billy C, love the show. And by the way, I have a question. Have you ever covered a fighter called Rinty Monahan from Belfast, Northern Ireland, in the Blast from the Past segment?" He says, "If so, you know, where can I get a copy of the podcast, blah, blah, blah." You know, he says that "I love all the parts of your show, but the Blast from the Past is my favorite section because often the fighters you've covered all had fascinating stories and not only gives a relatively young boxing fan like myself a real sense of what life was like for the fighters of bygone eras, but society at the time, too. I really think if it wasn't for your show, I would have never heard of guys like Charlie Burley, Billy Misk, etc. Thank you very much, and have a great holiday season." I want to thank Leon for taking the time, for sending us a mailbag. And, you know, I'm especially grateful for Leon because this is exactly what we do the Blast from the Past for, to try to educate our younger listeners, and even the older listeners, because Alex and myself learn something every day when we do the Blast from the Past, and it's a segment that we are going to be expanding. It's going to be a separate section that will be available, so people that are big fans of the Blast from the Past, which incidentally we used to do back when Jeremy actually did production work for this organization, and we used to submit the Blast from the Past separately to anybody that signed up for it. And we don't do that anymore. And we're going to, as soon as the new studio is done. And we will be submitting that on a weekly basis for everyone to check out. So we're looking forward to that, as well as our European show and a bunch of other things that are all starting at the new year, during the new year. So as far as responding to Leon Taylor's request, well, guess what? Next week, my man, Rinty Monahan will be our Blast from the Past. You can check it out Wednesday right here on the Talking Boxing with Billy C Radio Show. Thank you for the email. Thank you for the kudos. And we're going to keep up the good work. At least we're going to try. You know, I got to just comment on the Hall of Fame inductees. And now I'm not talking about the Billy C Boxing Hall of Fame inductees. I'm talking about the international inductees. You know, I mentioned earlier this week that I totally felt that Tommy the Hitman Hearns deserves it. And, you know, I was a little torn on Mark Tushop Johnson. I'm not saying he wasn't a quality fighter, and I'm not saying he wasn't a Hall of Famer. I just think that there was so many other guys on the ballot that could have gotten in sooner than him. I mean, he could have hung around the ballot for a little while and then got in. You know, that's my thought on him. Do I think he deserves to be there? Yes. You know, Tommy Hearns is obviously the big name. I'm especially happy for Al Bernstein and Freddie Roach and, of course, Michael Buffer. Now, Michael Katz I wasn't too hot on. But I got an email almost as long as the book called War and Peace from our very own Alex Papali, giving me all the reasons why Michael Katz is justifiable. Is a justifiable International Boxing Hall of Fame inductee. And I just want to go on the air and say, Alex, I'm sorry, man. You know, next time you want to put me in my place, could you just give me a recap of it, man? Do you have to go with all those miles and miles and miles? I had to get new glasses. I wore out my reading glasses from that email. But, you know what it is? And I'm kidding with Alex, of course. But you know what it is? I'm not sure I like, you know, these kinds of people in the Hall of Fame. You know, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe boxing writers should be in. Maybe announcers should be in. I don't know. Maybe I should be in. No. I guess I'll sing my tune differently if someday I ever get in, which I'm never going to get in there. I'm talking about get into a bar without paying an entry fee or something. But, you know, I don't know, man. From my opinion, I thought maybe the Boxing Hall of Fame should be, you know, dedicated to the boxers. At least the Billy C. Boxing Hall of Fame will be. So, anyway, I'm looking forward to Tommy the Hitman Hearns. I'm not sure I'm going to be attending. We'll have to wait and see if what kind of demand we have from you guys with the Billy C. get-together. If the demand is there, we will go. But other than that, I've lost some faith in the Hall of Fame, the way it's done. And, you know, although Marlon Starling told me, "You're coming," which meant, I guess, you know, he's going to smack me around if I don't. But, you know, I'm disappointed in the way that's evolved. And that was one of the reasons why we did our own thing. But nonetheless, I will tell you this. I won't be posing in any eyebrow pictures for what that's worth. But anyway, I want to start with the fights that we're going to be picking this week right now, because I don't want to run out of time. As a matter of fact, I want to remind everybody about the Holly Holm fight. I've been saying it all afternoon or all morning here. It is going to be replayed tonight. And if you're listening to the podcast and it's not tonight, if this is the tomorrow that you worried about yesterday already and you're playing this show one day behind like a lot of you do, then here's what you do. Just go up to BillyCBoxing.com and click the Wednesday night fight right in the middle of the screen, play it, and you'll get the whole show. We will be posting it sometime around noon, 1 p.m. Eastern time on Saturday. Will be available. The whole fight card will be available on demand on BillyCBoxing.com and also on YouTube/BillyCBoxing. So YouTube.com/BillyCBoxing. But if you want to watch the replay in its entirety, the whole show, which was a fantastic show, man. The last three fights are phenomenal. All of the fights are phenomenal, but the last three are all fighters to watch. You could check that out tonight, beginning at 8 p.m. Eastern Time on Ustream.com, on LDLTV, and BillyCBoxing.com. Here's the deal. We got some fights. The first fight I want to talk about is Gennady Golovkin against Luan Simon, which is taking place tonight. It's taking place tonight. That's why I'm reading that one first. Luan Simon is out of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. He's 33 years old. He's a former two-time world title challenger. He's got a record of 23 wins, 12 coming by knockout. Three losses, never been stopped, and he's got a couple of draws. You know, his last fight he lost to Deonzo Miranda, which I think puts this in perspective. I think Luan Simon is extremely overrated. However, and he's with a guy that's a real slime ball. You know the business of boxing really has a lot of slime balls in it, and Luan Simon's team consists of a whole slew of slime balls. So maybe that's been his problem. But the bottom line is this: if you look at his record, and you see how he started coming up. Now, he did fight Richard Grant back in 2005, which wasn't a bad fight at the time. But since then, I mean, just marginal opposition. I mean, you know, just guy Don Labby, he fought in 2005. Don Labby was a guy that fought out of, I believe, Maine. I had him on a card back in 2002, and he sucked then. You know, so I can't see how much better he got in 3 years. But, you know, nonetheless, these are the types of opposition that Luan Simon beat up on. But I got to give him credit where credit's due. He went in and went 12 rounds with two world champions in Germany. One for the middleweight world title against Arthur Abraham, when Arthur Abraham was really, I thought, at his peak, man. He goes 12 rounds with Arthur. And as a matter of fact, his team felt that he got robbed in that fight, which, you know, apparently, you know, they were wearing blinders, because I watched that fight, and there's no way that there's robbery. The only thing you could say is that Luan Simon won the first four rounds, like most people do, against Arthur Abraham. But that's it. And Arthur Abraham rocked him a couple of times in the latter part of the fight. But he did go 12 rounds with him. That was his first title shot, and unfortunately his first loss. Going into that fight, he had two draws, his second pro fight against Jose Diaz and Darnell Boone, who's a tough guy, but not that tough. Drew with Lamont Simon. He followed up that fight 3 months later with another fight against Sebastian Sylvester, and this one too was a for a title. This time it was for the IBF's international middleweight title, and he lost a 12-round decision there. He did fight Elvin Ayala, which was actually a pretty good fight. That got him back in the mix. And then he had two fights, one against Jose Angel Rodriguez, where I was ringside for that fight, and he struggled with this guy. Rodriguez went into that fight with an undefeated record, but, you know, if you punch him up, you'll see that he wasn't really much. And Simon struggled with this guy. And in his last fight, which was last year, he hasn't fought for almost a year, which was against Dionzio Miranda in Dover, in Delaware. He loses a split decision. Now, keep in mind, his Slimeball team is out of Delaware and the Pennsylvania area. So, you know, for him to lose a split decision in his hometown, really, he probably should have lost a unanimous decision. His best fight, really, was against Arthur Abraham. He did get a second win against Ayala, but I'm not sure where he's going to go from here. He's 33 years old, 6'1", 178 rounds as a professional with a 41% knockout ratio. Now he steps in the ring with the current WBA World Middleweight Champion. Now hold that thought. I'm going to take a short break, and when I come back, I'm going to give you the lowdown on Gennady Golovkin and then who I think is going to win in this fight, the world middleweight title fight, a world middleweight title fight, tonight. And we're back. You're listening to Dee Snider and Twisted Sister do their version of White Christmas here on the Talking Boxing with Billy C radio show. You're also watching us on the Fight Now channel. Don't forget to call your local television provider right now and tell them that you want the Fight Now channel added to your lineup. It's that simple. Call and you shall be... What is it? Ask and you shall receive. So call your television provider and ask for the Fight Now channel. Then maybe if you get it today, you'll be able to tune into the David Lemieux Alcine fight tomorrow night, exclusively in the U.S. on Fight Now. So now's the time to fight with the television provider and get the channel added to your lineup. We're breaking down the fights. I'm about to give my predictions. David Allen is mocking me in the chat room, saying that he's getting his tissues out, ready for the poor picks. I will tell you this. You know, I am having a rough year, but even so, I'm still way for gambling purposes, way up there at 78.3%, 292 out of 373 is my year to date, and that includes me picking a lot of fights with my heart, because you know, when I have a fighter on the show as a guest, I usually go their way, you know. But that's the kind of guy I am. I'm loyal. I'm not like these backstabbers that we got around. But the bottom line is this: Gennady Golovkin. I just gave you the broke down of Luan Simon. Gennady Golovkin, he's a WBA world middleweight champ. He's undefeated with 21-0, 18 knockouts. He's 5'10". He's only got 87 rounds as a professional with an 86% KO ratio. He's 29 years old. And he's from Kazakhstan. You know, when you look at this guy's resume, I say to myself, who's he for? I mean, when you look at all of the names, and, you know, yeah, he fought most of his fights in Europe and you know, definitely never in the United States. And I was confusing him with someone else, by the way, yesterday. So for everybody that's ready to, you know, send me these nasty emails. Hey, you got it all wrong. It wasn't Golovkin. It was Priorg that you were talking about on the HBO when they dissed him, blah, blah, blah. But anyway, you know, coming up before the guy in 2008, he fought Ian Gardner. Now, I know Ian Gardner is a real tough guy to beat. He had a very awkward style and everything. He was a tall, lanky fighter out of the New England area. And Golovkin beat him via an 8-round decision in his hometown. Now, since then, he's fought some guys that look good on paper. I'm not as familiar with them until he got his world title shot against Milton Nunez in 2010, and he made quick work of Nunez in the first round. As a matter of fact, he knocked him out in the first round, won the world title. Now, his title defenses, his two world title defenses since winning the title against Nunez, was against Nilson Julio Tapia, who had a 14-2 record, knocked him out in three. And then the old washed-up Kasim Uma, who he stopped in 10. You know, the jury's still out on Golovkin. And, you know, as far as Simon, I think they picked a really good opponent for Golovkin, because Simon is on the downside. He's on the downside, man. No matter how you slice it, he's on the downside. Golovkin needs to beat Simon, and he needs to knock him out. And if he does so, then maybe he'll start getting the recognition that they think he should be getting. But right now, you know, he's just a guy with a belt as far as I'm concerned. With that said, I'm picking him. I'm picking the guy with the belt. I'm picking the guy with the belt to retain his belt and to pick up the IBO middleweight championship against Luan Simon tonight. So my first pick, Gennady Golovkin over Luan Simon. The next fight I'm going to pick, which I didn't get a chance to ask Marty about, is a tough one. It's a tough one. Aaron Pryor Jr. is a former world title challenger, and that's because he titled Thomas Uzen on September 3rd of this year for the IBO's super middleweight title. Lost a 12-round decision. Now, he's got a record of 16 wins, 4 losses, never been stopped, 11 knockouts. He's 33 years old. We all know the story. He started late. We all know that he's the son of the great Aaron Pryor, the Hawk. Aaron Pryor Jr. is 33. He's got an 84-inch reach, 6'4". He played basketball, man. 104 rounds as a pro with a 55% KO ratio. Now, when he first started, this guy was nothing. And, I mean, it was a joke, okay? But somewhere along the line, and as far as I'm concerned, yes, he had a couple of losses. But when he stepped in the ring against Willis Lockett in Philly, and beat Willis Lockett, I started to see a change. I started to see a change. And then when he fought in November of 2008, of 2010, last year, when he stepped in the ring against Dia Davis, who's Howard Davis's son, I believe this fight was broadcast on Showbox. Dia Davis and Aaron Pryor Jr. had a really good fight. And what I learned in that fight, now it was a close fight. A lot of people think Dia Davis won the fight. But the official win went to Aaron Pryor Jr. as a unanimous 8-round decision. What I saw in this fight was Aaron Pryor finally learning how to fight, to use his jab and everything else. Now, he didn't have much of an amateur career, so like some of these other young fighters, he kind of developed before our eyes. Here's the thing. He looked good, but instead of maybe giving him another lesser opposition, build up his confidence a little bit, they got a little cocky, and they went right for Edwin Rodriguez. Now, La Bamba was a highly regarded fighter, and a lot of people thought that La Bamba was going to destroy Aaron Pryor, including myself. And what we found was that Aaron Pryor Jr., again, similar to the Dia Davis fight, looked pretty solid. And I thought that I thought that this fight either ended in a draw or he actually squeaked out a victory over Edwin Rodriguez. Now, the official judges saw it totally different. They saw the fight a unanimous 10-round decision for Edwin La Bamba Rodriguez. I'm sorry, but I just watched this fight again before I made my selection yesterday. And I think Aaron Pryor won that fight. Aaron Pryor Jr. won that fight. Nonetheless, he followed that up with a very good performance against Lombardo Andrade. Yes, the Lombardo Andrade, and beat him via a majority decision when he fought Thomas Uzun Dazen back in September of this year. He lost a 12-round decision. You know, I figured it would deter him a little bit, but no, he's stepping right back in the ring, and he's taking on Adonis Stevenson this weekend. Now, Adonis Stevenson is a NABA super middleweight champ. This title is on the line, as well as the vacant NABO super middleweight title. Adonis Stevenson has a 15-1 record, 12 coming by knockouts. His only loss, he was stopped, and that was against Darnell Boone. Remember I mentioned Darnell Boone before? Darnell Boone, a tough guy, but how tough is Adonis Stevenson if he got knocked out by Darnell Boone at the time? No, in April of 2010, 16 wins, 15 losses, 2 draws was what Darnell Boone had. He followed it up with 2 wins. Derek Edwards and Deion Savage. Derek Edwards and Deion Savage both have impressive records. Edwards is 25-1. Savage was 11-1. Knocked both of these guys out. I thought they were good comeback wins. Now, he did have an early win in his career back in 2007 against Marlon Hayes, which was really his first big win. He also beat Dafir Smith. And, Dafir Smith was a journeyman fighter, tough guy, and he stopped him. He also had a win against Anthony Bisonti, which was another tough guy. What does it all mean? He's a former Canadian super middleweight champ. He's 5'11". He's 49 rounds as a pro with a 75% knockout ratio. Adonis Stevenson, yeah, he's a good fighter. He's a southpaw. He's 34 years old. He's actually a year older than Aaron Pryor Jr. He's the hometown guy. He's all it is. His nickname is the Superman. Who am I picking? I'm not picking the Superman, man. I think that Aaron Pryor is going to be the kryptonite for Adonis Stevenson tonight or tomorrow night. I'm picking Aaron Pryor Jr. with an upset. I'm picking a dog here in that one. So I'm picking Aaron Pryor Jr. over Adonis Stevenson in that fight tomorrow night. The next one I'm picking is going to be a good one, and you can catch it right here on Fight Now. Who am I picking in that one? Well, you're going to have to wait for me to give you my schmeal first. David Lemieux, he's a former Canadian middleweight champion. He's from Montreal. He's never fought outside of Canada. Interesting thing, he's got 26 professional fights, 25 wins, 1 loss, 24 of his W's coming by knockout. His 1 loss, he was stopped. We all know the fight. Marco Antonio Rubio was stopped in the 7th round. He's got a 64-inch reach, 5'10.5", 62 rounds as a pro with a 92% knockout ratio. Here's the thing, 26 pro fights, he's 22 years old. In 2010, he fought 5 times on his way up, and he really wanted to start off 2011 with a title shot, and a win over Marco Antonio Rubio would have gotten him just that. It would have been him against Chavez Jr., but instead, everything went awry because Marco Antonio Rubio did not play according to plan, and Marco Antonio Rubio let this kid wear himself down, which David Lemieux did. And ultimately knocked him out in the 7th round. It was actually a TKO. He was on his way to getting hurt. And his then corner man, trainer, and manager, Russ Amber, threw in the towel. Now, I mention that because it's a very important chain of events that took place after that. After that, Lemieux was understandably depressed. And, his relationship with Russ started to deteriorate. As a matter of fact, he wasn't doing the things that Russ wanted him to do in the gym, and it ultimately led to a breakup. This will be the first fight that David Lemieux will have when Russ Amber is not the voice in the corner. And I think that this is a lot more than people might think it is. This is a bigger deal than people might think it is. He's got 62 rounds as a professional with a 92% knockout ratio. His last fight was 8 months ago already. 8 months ago. His two big wins of his career, really, he actually had three. He did fight the tough Jason Nagler, who's, you know, doesn't have an impressive record, but the kid is tough. He goes the distance. That was the first guy that ever went the distance with Lemieux. He followed that up with a very impressive performance against Vladimir Shmishay. Elvin Ayala, he knocked out in one round. Hector Camacho Jr., he knocked out in about 20 seconds. And he also stopped Pernell Gates. All decent fighters, though, from Vladimir Shmishay up through the Gates fight. Impressive on paper, which got his confidence up, and he was put in the ring with Rubio, and we all know what happened in that fight. Now he's stepping in the ring with a fighter, Joseem Alsayn. Now Joseem Alsayn is much older than him at 35 years old. He's got more experience, 32 wins, 2 losses, 1 draw, 19 of his W's come by knockout, and of his 2 losses, stop both times. He's got 214 rounds as a professional with a 54% knockout ratio, 73 entries, 5'10.5". Now, his 2 knockout losses, who did they come to, by, from, whatever? Daniel Santos, when he lost the world title back in 2008, he was knocked out in 6. And a year and a half ago, on July 17th in 2010, Alfredo Angulo made quick work of Alsayn and knocking him out in 1 round. Now, here's the thing. He had 3 big wins in 2006. Anderson Clayton, Javier Alberto Mami, and Jose Joaquin Rosa Gromez. All 3 wins catapulted him into a world title shot, and that's what he got on July 7th, 2007, against Travis Sims in Connecticut. Won a 12-round decision, had a successful defense against Alfonso Mosquera, and then he faced Daniel Santos, and we all know what happened after that. He followed that up with an impressive 10-round decision over Eric Mitchell and fought Christophe Canclou in December of 2009 before he fell prey to Alfredo Angulo. His last fight was this year, August 20th, my sister's birthday, against Jose Medina, who was 14-9 and got a draw out of that. A lot of people think he's finished. I don't know if he's finished. But I will give you my prediction for tonight, for tomorrow night's fight. I'm picking David Lemieux in a comeback fight, and I do think he's going to come out not only victorious, but he's going to knock out Alsayn. So that's my pick there. The next fight could very well be the fight of the weekend. It's the fourth fight that we're picking, Brian Valoria against Giovanni Segura. I'm so glad that Integrated Sports is going to be offering this here in the United States. Check out their website or check your local listings. I highly recommend this fight, Giovanni Segura against Brian Valoria. Brian Valoria is the former World Junior Flyweight champ. He's currently the WBO Flyweight champion. He's got a record of 29 wins, 16 come by knockout, 3 losses, and he's only stopped one time. It's called the Pinoy Punch. He's 31 years old, 5'4", 65 inch reach, 252 rounds as a professional with a 47% knockout ratio. Who did he get knocked out by? Carlos Tamara in January of last year. So almost a year has been going on since that fight. And that's when he lost his junior flyweight title in the 12th round. Now, he got his new flyweight. This was junior flyweight title that he lost to Tamara. But he got his flyweight title this past July when he won a 12-round decision against Julio Cesar Miranda, who had a record of 35-5-1. We all know him. Now, he's had some big fights, but, you know, like Marty was saying earlier, you know, every time that this guy was on his way up and you're ready to say, okay, he's the real deal, something would happen and he would lose, you know. And it seems like those 3 losses were sporadically located throughout his career. And, you know, a lot of people think that he's coming back. As a matter of fact, he's the favorite in this fight, which kind of surprises me. Now, he steps in the ring with Giovanni Segura. Now, I happen to be... Giovanni Segura is like one of my favorite fighters. I could very well be his number one fan. He's a former world junior flyweight champion, and he's only lost one time. He's got a record of 28 wins, 1 loss, 1 draw. 24 of his 28 wins have come by knockout. He's only 29 years old. His loss, well, that came at the hands of Cesar Canchilla. and Cancilla, those two fights were fantastic. He lost a 12-round decision. It was a great fight on July 26th in 2008. They followed that up in March of 2009, and this time Segura made no bones about who was the better fighter, knocking out Cancilla in the fourth round. Now, you know, when you look at this guy's record and you start looking at who he's fought, you know, I was amazed because yesterday when I really was – now, I've always been a Segura fan, but yesterday I realized if you look at this guy's record, I mean, go look at his pro debut. His pro debut was against Jesus Valadez, who was 2-2. Now, remember, pro debut fighters usually are fighting other pro debut fighters, maybe a guy that's 0-2 or something. I mean, whatever. You know, to step in the ring in your pro debut against a guy with four professional fights, I don't care if he was 0-4. You know, that's tough. And what happens? He gets a unanimous decision. So what do they do? They throw him in the ring with Benjamin Garcia, who was 7-1-2. They threw him in a couple of months later, and he gets a draw. That's understandable. In his second pro fight, he gets a draw fighting a guy with 10 pro fights. And then that set up a rematch. A couple of weeks later, not a couple of months, a couple of weeks, the first fight was held on July 5th in 2003, and then July 19th, 2003, Benjamin Garcia and Giovanni Segura go at it again. This time, Segura knocks him out in the first round. I mention that fight because if you look at the next 14 or 13 fights, I should say, they were all against quality opposition for a young fighter. I mean, this guy's fighting guys like Francisco Arce. In his 14th professional fight, Arce was 20 wins, 2 losses, and 2 draws. Knocks him out in the first round. I mean, look up who he fought as a young fighter. From that point on, from that Francisco Arce fight on, which was in 2006, you could argue that he had fought nobody that wasn't a quality fighter ever since. His weakest opponent, really, the only fight that I can find, in my opinion, that really is against a weak opponent took place on January 20th in 2006 against Juan Carlos Perez, who was a 1-11-3 fighter. From that point, that's it. In his whole career, that's the only, what I'm going to call, a weak fighter. Now, you could argue and say his last fight was an easy fight, too. I'll give you that. It was the easiest fight since the 1-11 guy, and that was against Eddie Zuniga, who was 7-5. But who's he beat? How about Ivan Calderon? Nobody predicted that he would beat Ivan Calderon except me. Go back and listen to the show last year. I predicted that he would win, and he did. I also predicted that he would win the rematch, and he did. And he's also got wins over Manuel Vargas, Walter Tilo, Sonny Boyaro, who's a real tough guy, Juanito Rubilar, tough fighter. Listen, what can I say about this guy? Not any more than I already have. 29 years old, 5'4", 69-inch reach, 119 rounds as a pro with an 80% knockout percentage. Who am I picking in this one? Brian Valoria or Giovanni Segura? That's an easy one. Giovanni Segura. And not only do I think he's going to win, I think he's actually going to destroy Brian Valoria. And that might be the end of Brian Valoria for a little while anyway. Final fight I'm picking, Amir Khan against Lamont, you dummy, Peterson. And I'm going to reiterate, I say you dummy not because I think Lamont Peterson is a dummy. I think Lamont from Sanford and Son is a dummy. If you don't know what that show is, if you're too young, punch it up, man. Go punch it up. TV Land or whatever they have. Lamont Peterson is a former World Junior Welterweight champion, as a matter of fact, because when he fought Willie Blaine, I believe it was for an interim title, and he gets the credit of being a former world champion, which is BS, but nonetheless, he fought Willie Blaine in 2009, and immediately, a few months later, fought Timothy Bradley, lost that title, and it's kind of had a weird career since. Now, I look at this guy's record, and from his first fight all the way up until the fight prior to Leonardo Tyner was against, progressively increased opposition, which is the way to go. And I thought that was the exact move. I would have done the same thing with my young fighter if Lamont Peterson was worked with me. He's got a 29 wins, 15 of them of those wins come by knockout. He's got one loss, never was stopped, and one draw. 5'9", 74-inch reach, 195 rounds of pro with a 48% KO ratio. Now, from that fight, from that last fight in July of 2008, a ninth-round TKO of a Rogelio Castaneda Jr., he stepped in with Leonardo Tyner. Now, remember that fight. This was billed as a pretty tough fight. Tyner was on his way up, Peterson on his way up, and this was an entertaining affair. And Peterson won a 10-round decision, which set him up for the Willie Blaine fight, which he knocked out in the seventh round. Now, here's where I think things went a little crazy for Lamont, you dummy, Peterson. You know, he fights Willie Blaine. He wins that title. He gets in the ring with Timothy Bradley and loses that fight, a 12-round decision against Timothy Bradley. Now, he kind of all of a sudden started dealing with this upper echelon level of fighter where I think that they rushed him. From the jump that went from Leonardo Tyner up to Timothy Bradley was too great of a jump. But here's the problem. They haven't gone back down to that. Yes, Damian Fuller isn't exactly a world beater, and he knocked him out in seven. But then they put him in with Victor Ortiz. In my opinion, Lamont Peterson won that fight. He did get a majority draw decision against Victor Ortiz. I thought he won that fight. In his last fight, he fought Victor KO, which was not an easy fight either. He came out and won by a 12th-round knockout, which sets up this fight. Now, Lamont Peterson, yes, he's in his hometown. Yes, he's fighting out of D.C. Yes, he's fighting Amir Khan. But Amir Khan, listen, we know about Amir Khan. He's a former, he's the current junior welterweight champion. I'm going to call him the junior welterweight champion because he owns the WBA super junior middleweight champion belt, not to be confused with their regular old champion belt. He's also got the IBF junior welterweight title as well. King Khan is what he goes by now. 26 wins, 18 come by knockout, one loss, and he was stopped, and we all know that deal. 2008, September 6th, he fights Brennus Prescott in what was supposed to be a homecoming for him, so to speak, in Manchester, and he gets blown out in the first round, knocked out. Everybody bailed on this guy. That was 3 years ago. And it was also before Freddie Roach. Freddie Roach gets added to the mix and showcases 3 months later against Usain Fagan, knocks out Usain Fagan in two. Now, I will put a little asterisk next to that because Usain Fagan broke his leg. Not that the outcome would have been any different, but we started to see a change in Amir Khan. The next fight was that blood fest against Marco Antonio Barrera. Yes, he looked good. I personally think that fight should have been stopped and ruled a no contest and made these two guys have a rematch. But instead, they let that fight go until they could go to the scorecards. Barrera was bleeding like a stuck pig after that first round, and there's no way that fight should have continued. But nonetheless, Amir Khan was dominating, and we started to see what was beginning to come the new and improved Amir Khan. In his next fight against Andrei Kotatnik, many people believe he got a gift in that fight. Many people believe he got a gift in that fight. I think he won that fight, hands down, like he did against everybody since then. Dimitri Salida, Paulie Malignaggi. Now, the Marcos Maidana fight, we saw a lot of things in that fight. Number one, we saw how tough Marcos Maidana is. And number two, Amir Khan wanted to show us that he could take a punch from a puncher like Marcos Maidana, and he did. Almost cost him the fight, but he took it, won a decision. He followed that up with a beatdown of Paul McCluskey. And in his last fight, when he picked up the IBF portion of the belt, he knocked out Zab Judah in the fifth. What does it all mean? I love Lamont Peterson, but Amir Khan has just evolved into too good of a fighter. I'm picking Amir Khan. So my picks for this week are Gennady Golovkin over Lawan Simon. I'm taking Aaron Pryor Jr. over Donna Stevenson. David Lemieux over Alcima Sign. I'm taking Giovanni Segura over Brian Valora, and I'm taking Amir Khan over Lamont, you dummy, Peterson. So I wish everybody in the Billy C Challenge good luck, except, of course, David Allen and Dave Murphy. Both of those guys, I hope they lose every fight, you know, because I'm that kind of a guy. I'm a sore loser, you know. Both of them are ahead of me, and that's it. You know, it's just them. It's those two. Everybody else, I don't care. Everybody else could beat me. As long as I finish ahead of Murphy and David Allen, I'm okay. So let's all vote for them to lose. Hey, just a reminder real quick. Don't forget, on Fight Now TV, Saturday night from Montreal, you're going to get to see the David Lemieux and Joseem Alsine fight live. So if you have, if you don't have Fight Now on your channel lineup, now's the time to call your local television provider and tell them you want it so you can watch this fight. Also, tomorrow night, beginning at 8 p.m., on the Dish Network, I believe, and some other television outlets. IntegratedSportsMedia.net. Check it out. IntegratedSportsNet.com. Check it out for where you can find the Giovanni Segura and Brian Valoria fight. And, of course, you can get the replay of the Holly Holm, Sophie Ann Mathis fight on www.youtube.com/BillyCBoxing anytime Saturday. You can also play it under the Wednesday Night Fights banner on BillyCBoxing.com. Or if you want to see it tonight, because it's going to be aired exclusively on LDL TV through Ustream.com. So check out Ustream tonight beginning at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. Trust me when I tell you, this is a great fight, and you do not want to miss it.
Wake up. It's time for the...
It's too early for a trivia question.
Question.
I put you losers out of your misery for a while. Now, I mean, I promise you that those three that you've been stumped on, the last three trivia questions that you've been stumped on, are coming back. They're coming back soon, so don't think they're out of your life forever, because they're not. But we got a new one for you today, because I feel sorry for you, all right? I feel sorry for you. And my man Keith DeSara reminded me about this. You know, he stumped me on it because I forgot the names of the fighters. But you know what? This, too, is a recycled question. And I know we had a winner for this. I don't remember who it was because I don't have my notes in front of me. But Keith pointed out that this is a tough question. And by the way, Keith and I never got a chance to talk, but I'm going to hopefully he'll give me a shout at my home number immediately after the show. Give me 15 minutes, Keith. Give me a shout. I know he's listening. I got to ask him about the feature fighter segment. Here's the thing. Here's the question. What was the only world title fight during the gloved era of boxing that was fought barefoot? Now, both of the combatants were barefoot, okay? So that's important. What was the only world title fight during the gloved era that was fought barefoot? If you know this answer, email me, Billy@TalkinBoxing. That's TalkinBoxing.com. And, of course, Keith DeSara is not allowed to answer this question, and he's not allowed to give the answer out, Keith. So I don't care how many millions of dollars that these Murphys send you. Don't give it the answer. One more time. What was the only world title fight during the gloved era that was fought barefoot? If you know this answer, email me, Billy@TalkinBoxing. That's TalkinBoxing.com. And as usual, if you're a Fight Now viewer, you'll get a bonus prize.
This day in boxing history.
And finally, on this day, December 9th in 2000, Virgil Hill knocks out Fabrice Tazio in the first round to win the WBA World Cruiserweight title. And that took place on this day, December 9th, in France. That took place on this day in France. That concludes our show for today. Hey, make sure you tune in next week. Our Blast from the Past is going to feature a request from a listener, Leon Taylor. Got to give a shout-out to him from East London in England. We're going to be doing it on Rinty Monahan. Now, the heavyweight spotlight is going to be on a former World Heavyweight Champion and Boxing Hall of Famer, Jack Dempsey. I forgot to do him this week. So the feature fighter, well, you'll have to wait and check out what's coming up on the website to find out that, www.billycboxing.com. But the most important thing to remember, make sure you tune in tomorrow morning, same bat time. I should say Monday morning. Same bat time, same bat channel, the Fight Now channel. Call your local television provider right now and tell them that you want the Fight Now channel added to your lineup. For all the information on the channel, visit their website, www.fightnow.com. Hey, man, enjoy all the fights this weekend, especially the ones on Fight Now. And, of course, tonight's Holly Holm and Sophie Mathis fight. But the most important thing, man, make sure you tune in Monday morning. You know the deal. Ciao, baby.